over. The most dangerous man in Europe is about to arrive on Britain's shores. His preachings are so incendiary, he's been forced out of his native country. Only liberal Britain will tolerate his presence on her soil. He heads to London to live in exile. The year is 1849. But today, that man's writings are still dangerous. They're so radical, so revolutionary, they continue to divide the world. It's been more than 150 years since he started writing about the world. But you know what? If you're looking for an explanation of the global economic crisis, he's a surprisingly good place to start. With everything going so wrong, you have to wonder, is Karl Marx turning out to be right? Most people know Marx as the father of communism. You might be surprised to hear that most of what he wrote was about capitalism. And today, his ideas about that are being taken seriously right at the heart of global business.
His analysis was pretty on the button and explains a lot, I think, about some of the things that we see going on around in our economy today.
For Marx, the best argument against capitalism was that it was inherently unfair. His ideas on inequality have more resonance than ever today. Capitalism. Karl Marx had the most radical advice of all. Get rid of it.
When this wall came down, I was just studying economics at university. Back then, we knew, or we thought we knew, two things about Marxism, communism. One was it hadn't delivered freedom for the workers, quite the opposite. The other, just as bad if you're an economist, was it hadn't delivered prosperity. The communist approach to the economy just hadn't worked.
While the free market West took great strides, the communist planned economies had been left behind. Marx's reputation as an economist was in shreds. When times were good, Marx was nowhere. But now the Western economies are in crisis, he's attracting new interest right at the heart of the economic establishment. From a former IMF chief economist,
Marx is right on a number of dimensions. He certainly is right that income inequality can be a source of tremendous tension.
To the man who saw the 2008 crisis coming.
He understood that there are situations in which capitalism and globalization can lead to economic crisis.
Said about capitalism that rings so true today.
Marx's key insight was that capitalism was inherently unstable. He said we'd lurch from crisis to crisis and society would become increasingly unequal.
Marx divided the world into bosses and workers. For him, they would always be at odds, and that battle was a recipe for crises. To make profit, bosses squeeze what they pay workers. The crisis comes when workers then don't have enough money to buy what bosses are trying to sell them.
Now, for decades after World War II, that looked completely wrong. We had years of stable growth, and the workers were taking a larger and larger share of the pie. But not anymore.
Marx would explain this crisis in terms of the fact that ordinary people haven't got enough money to spend. Why haven't they got enough money to spend? because there's been a big redistribution over the last few decades away from ordinary people towards capital, towards wealth.
Capitalism would produce bigger and bigger crises, and then it would collapse.
How would Marx have suggested solving the crisis is, of course, by abolishing capitalism.
Here's why I've been thinking more about Marx. It's because the last few years hasn't felt like an ordinary recession. It hasn't felt like a crisis for one economy or for a group of economies in the West. At times, it really has felt like a crisis for the system, for capitalism as we know it. You want a bigger explanation. And no one's ever had a bigger explanation for everything that's happened than Karl Marx.
Today, his birthplace makes its own contribution to the local economy. It's a big draw for tourists. But for all his ambitions, Marx was hardly a model student. When he was at university in Berlin, he earned a reputation as a radical thinker.
By the time he was 24, Dr. Marx was a bit of a Renaissance man. He was an expert in law, philosophy, you name it. In fact, the only thing he didn't know much about was economics.
For Marx, it all begins with private property, which divides the world starkly. There are those that have it and those that don't.
Take this wood. Before it became private property, I could do what I like with it. I could heat my house with it. I could make a chair and exchange it for food. But if it belongs to someone else, the whole relationship changes. Now Marx would say, I've become a member of the proletariat. Now I have to work for the owner of the wood, the capitalist, for a wage. Then he can sell what I've made for more than he paid me. Look what's happened. Something that was part of my life is now a financial transaction. And the capitalist made profit. He can use that to buy more wood, build factories, make more profit. And so it goes on. Profit is now the heart of everything. Profit is now the heart of everything. Profit is now the heart of everything. The key point for us is that that driving force of capitalism, the need to earn more and more profit, well, Marx thought that was also a recipe for constant crises.
So Marx would say you could trace the roots of the crisis we're in today right to the very heart of capitalism, to its need to generate profit. We might see a complex modern economy which all of us have a stake in, but Marxists would say the same old rules still apply. For them, who owns what still means everything. They see workers still slaving away, and capitalists or bourgeoisie still exploiting them, always striving to make more profit. In Marx's world, any capitalist that doesn't seek maximum profit is soon replaced by one who does. So the system follows a completely predictable course, he would say, to its own destruction. It's not an idea that many people accept.
He was completely wrong, including the idea that capitalism was merely a phase and contained within it the seeds of its own destruction.
You'd be forgiven for thinking the total collapse of capitalism sounds a little implausible. How could seeking profit be so disastrous when it's done such amazing things? Just look at how we eat under capitalism. We get fresh fruit flown in from all over the world. We can choose from 700 types of breakfast cereal. We have enough of it, and it's all safe to eat. This incredible plenty and the technology it depends on didn't come from the state. It's what happens when you let capitalists compete for profit. They didn't do it for our benefit. They did it because it made them rich. So at first glance, Marx's idea that capitalism's search for profit would be its downfall sounds absurd.
Profit may often sound venal, it may often sound wrong, but it is what pushes progress ahead. Profit is actually what drives the world forward. Profit is actually what drives the world forward. And that's what Marx could never quite handle.
The Communist Manifesto. Engels to write one of the most incendiary pamphlets of all time. Then Karl Marx and his sidekick Friedrich Engels to...
Some of this you probably know. The famous opening line, a spectre is haunting Europe. And of course, the end, about the workers having nothing to lose but their chains. They have a world to win. Working men of all countries unite, in capital letters. But what you probably don't know, what I find most interesting, is what's in the middle. One of the most perceptive and admiring bits of writing about capitalism I've ever read.
The truth is, Marx did understand that the drive for profit would achieve incredible things.
It has been the first to show what man's activity can bring about. It's accomplished wonders far surpassing Egyptian pyramids, Roman aqueducts, and Gothic cathedrals. It has conducted expeditions that put in the shade all former exoduses of nations and crusades.
He did really get the kind of global aspect. He got the idea that people were suddenly being able to get things from all the way around the world in a completely new way, and the impact of that.
The need of a constantly expanding market for its products chases the bourgeoisie over the whole surface of the globe.
It must nestle everywhere, settle everywhere, establish connections everywhere. It creates a world after its own image.
But you know, there's got to be a downside for the bourgeoisie. The bourgeoisie, therefore, produces, above all, is its own grave diggers. Its fall and the victory of the proletariat are equally inevitable.
How can Marx think the capitalists, the bourgeoisie, are so brilliant and yet so doomed? Well, for him, it all came down to the way they treat their staff.
To understand Marx's analysis of crises, we have to first understand the capitalism that he knew. 19th century capitalists might have built wonders surpassing Egyptian pyramids, but they also forced their workers to endure terrible conditions and pay.
It is difficult to overstate the horror of industrialisation in Europe. In 1829, Liverpool, for example, a life expectancy at birth was about 28 years. And that was the lowest age since the Black Death. So the impact of the Industrial Revolution on life chances was absolutely terrifying.
By 1849, his revolutionary writings had got Marx banned from everywhere but Britain. Here he could observe the power money had to ruin lives. At a suitably safe distance, of course.
I think in the last few minutes I've come closer to what it was actually like, the drudgery of Victorian times, than Karl Marx ever did. He never went to a mine, and as far as we can tell, he only went to a factory once towards the end of his life. But it didn't stop him writing vividly about the horrors of Britain's dark satanic mills.
Minimum pay for proles meant maximum profits for bosses. And any bosses who did choose to pay more usually went bust.
He thought that...
Marx was wrong. He thought it would all get so bad, the workers would overthrow the system. Yet even as he was writing, reformers were beginning to get rid of the worst employment practices. Capitalism got kinder, not nastier. But the idea that the competing interests of bosses and workers would cause crises Well, that does seem relevant today. Now, here's the mine owner, capitalist. Miners, with or without hat. Now, imagine that there aren't very many miners around. Then, the mine owner has to compete with the other capitalists for workers. Probably ends up having to pay them more than he'd like to. Trouble is, those higher costs cut into profits. Now, if that's happening across the economy, you've got a declining rate of profit and a lot of capitalists going out of business. You get a crisis. You get countless workers losing their jobs, having a terrible time, until finally wages fall far enough, the capitalists can go back to exploiting them again. So, high labour costs are bad for business. But what makes the collapse of capitalism inevitable for Marx is that the bosses are in trouble even when they have things their own way. Now imagine the opposite situation. You've got loads of workers, all of this lot, competing for a single job. Then, well, no wonder he's smiling. The capitalist only has to pay the workers the bare minimum. This bucket is what Marx would have called the industrial reserve army of the unemployed. As long as that's full, this lot can keep paying very low wages and keep making profits. Except, in the end, there's a problem. Because badly paid workers don't spend very much, and not very much spending in an economy is not good for business. You get another crisis, more capitalists going bust, and this crisis is going to be harder to fix. So you can see why Marx thought the capitalists were in trouble no matter what they do. They never want to pay the workers more money. They always need to make more profit. But in seeking out profit, they end up eroding the basis on which it's made. They've forgotten, if you like, where their money ultimately comes from. The punchline, as ever with Marx, is that capitalism is doomed. Capitalists won in the 1980s, and they kept on winning. Guaranteed high wages and job security that workers had enjoyed until the 70s had gone. And downward pressure on wages started to lay the seeds of the crisis we see today. Well, we know the Marxist view of history is right about one thing. At least in Britain and America, earnings at the very top have soared in the last few years and everyone else has been squeezed. In Britain, real earnings have been flat or falling for the best part of 10 years, since before the crisis. And in America, that's been happening since the 70s.
In the United States, a full-time male worker, median, income has stagnated for a third of a century. No increase. Household income today is the same as it was 15 years ago. All the increase of the income has gone to the top.
The share of income in the United States that was going to the top 1% of the households 20 years ago was around 12%. Today, that share is closer to 23%.
So why do I think all that money's been flowing to the top? Well, I don't think it's a big conspiracy, but there have been social and political changes that have made a difference. We used to have really big unions. We used to have very high tax rates on rich people. And we had social norms. It just wasn't done for the people running a bank to take a huge chunk of the profits for themselves. Those things help keep a lid on inequality. We don't have them anymore. But really crucial to all of this has been the changing structure of our economy.
A lot of it's down to new technology. Work previously done by hand is now done by machines. Fewer workers needed, there are more competing for every job, meaning bosses can pay them less. But perhaps the most significant factor is globalization. With falling barriers to trade around the world, global business has gained access to a giant new pool of cheaper labor.
You have brought
many workers in the rich countries are now competing with an industrial reserve army running into the billions.
Remember, Marx didn't underestimate capitalism. He thought it was fundamentally flawed. He didn't think it was stupid. If large parts of the population weren't being paid enough to support demand, well, he wouldn't have been at all surprised to hear the capitalists had come up with a brilliant solution. The credit card. With consumer credit, people can carry on spending even if they haven't got the money. The economy stays afloat and the capitalists still make their profit. So credit provided an answer to all of capitalism's woes, but only for a while. Remember, Marx thought the system was fundamentally flawed. They might be very clever, these capitalists, but now more than ever, they were living on borrowed time. As we know, it went well beyond credit cards. What ultimately brought the crisis to a head was the billions borrowed on mortgages. People thought the value of their house would keep going up forever.
Housing credit.
In America, it happened on a massive scale. There, as we know, the capitalists were getting richer and richer. They couldn't spend all of their extra money. Driven, as ever, by the desire to make more profit, they lent it out in riskier and riskier ways. The name given to this lending might well be familiar. Subprime.
What we did is, as the incomes of most Americans were stagnating or even declining, we said, don't let it bother you. Keep spending as if your income was going up. And they did that very well.
In retrospect, it seems obvious. Lending to people who couldn't afford it wasn't a lasting solution to anything. It led to a housing bubble, which burst, threatening some of the world's biggest banks. And thanks to our integrated world, what started in the United States spread and infected the entire system, causing a global recession.
So here's the Marxist explanation for the crisis we've just seen. You've got a global economy with businesses getting better and better at squeezing wages and pushing up profits. But there's a problem. They're producing a lot of stuff that the workers can no longer afford, and a lot of profits looking for a new home. The global property bubble provided an answer to both those problems. The system was kept afloat on a mountain of debt, but it was only a matter of time before it all came crashing down.
What Marx would say is that we have to look for ways out of this crisis which look beyond the restoration of capitalist class power. And I think this is a time when we actually need to start thinking about the revolutionary solution again.
But who exactly is revolting against whom? Marx divided the world neatly into workers and capitalists, but today his stark distinction is incredibly blurred. Bosses work for themselves and workers own shares. In our modern world, enough of us do have a stake in the system, whether mobile phones or pension plans, to stave off talk of armed revolt. But what about the people capitalism's failing? What does Marx have to say to them?
It's really amazing how well Marx seems to understand our world, where we're more interconnected than he could ever have imagined, and where all the faces of capitalism, good and bad, are now on display in pretty much every corner of the globe. But he was the one who famously said it wasn't enough to interpret the world, the point was to change it. If you ask him what exactly we're supposed to replace capitalism with, well, he had remarkably little to say about that. We need to understand, for the last time, I promise, a bit more Marxist theory. As usual, he had a grand analysis of the history of the world. He saw the great sweep of humanity's endeavours from the caveman to the slave societies of Greece and Rome to the feudalism of kings and castles, all of which was replaced in turn by our own capitalist system of bosses and workers. Incredibly, incredibly unfair, but also incredibly productive. There weren't any revolutions in the rich, developed countries, as Marx predicted. Instead, it happened in one of the world's poorest nations. Soviet Russia may have left Marx far behind, but it was an attempt to try something else, and many have drawn lessons from its failure.
The truth is, at the moment, there are different forms of capitalism. But on the big argument about whether you really want to have a communist system or a capitalist one, that is pretty much one everywhere, I think.
There are more humane versions of capitalism or more barbaric forms of capitalism. But I don't think there's a systemic alternative to capitalism. Will there ever be? Yes, I would think so. I mean, you know, nothing is forever, absolutely nothing. And capitalism is not forever.
Marx died in 1883. In a speech at his grave, his longtime friend and collaborator Friedrich Engels declared his name and work will endure through the ages. For most of the 20th century, his name did endure, though usually for all the wrong reasons. But now it's the 21st century. What can this long-dead Prussian really say to us? Fundamentally, I think Marx reminds us that if capitalism doesn't work for everyone, it might not work at all.
Some of the ugliness of capitalism that he saw in the 19th century seems to be reappearing in the 20th, in 21st. And in a way, we have to keep our perspective on this. Health conditions are much better. Living standards are starting from a higher level. But it is still the case that things aren't the way they ought to be. And they're not moving in the way they should be.
But let's face it, Marx wasn't just talking about tweaking the system. He had a much grander claim than that.
Did Marx change the world? Of course he did. And after that funeral, people did weep hot tears at his grave. Probably many more lived to curse his name. But there's no getting around it. Capitalism's still here.
Marx was right to see capitalism as inherently unstable and often unfair. Keynes and Hayek saw that too, but Marx was the first. And unlike them, he didn't think we should find a way to live with it. He said capitalism would bounce back from crises and reinvent itself, but in the end, a compelling alternative would appear and capitalism would collapse.
For all that rings true now in Marx, on that he seems to have been dead wrong.
Maybe he did underestimate capitalism. He certainly overestimated the opposition to it. I think the system needs to reinvent itself now, again. If it can pull that off, we'll be talking even less about Marx a century from now. But the last few years have left capitalism with plenty to prove.